Both from India. We have Dr. B. R. Mani, Director General, National Museum, New Delhi, India. So, if you want to visit National Museum in Delhi, please be friend with him. Yeah, I didn't know him earlier. I should have known him much earlier because I was in India for quite long and. Had visit to India quite often, but we didn't know him, so no special permission or special reception there. So next time, I hope, and we all hope, we will have a special reception. Next, co-chair, Professor, very illustrious Professor, Dr. Lalit Gupta, former professor, Fine Arts College, University of Jammu. I've been to Jammu twice and been to the universities. And we had MOU between our universities, Senu Raj Jabodis University and University of Jammu. But we have not done much to honor the MOU. We hope that in the future we can do some project together. So without taking your time, please, the both distinguished chair and co-chair, the floor is yours.
Good morning. The new Honorable teachers and distinguished participants. I welcome all of you today in the session 5, in which we have my favor. And hopefully we will try to complete it within time so that there may not be any delay for the big system to take their meal. The world today has to choose between so many extremes that it is difficult to say what the present world would be like, say, after a quarter of a century. The past, with its miraculous achievements and emphasis on mass production, should have paved the way to a greater human happiness. But far from it, it has barely helped mankind to devise new ways and means to a more complicated living. To overcome these complexities in life, one may have shelter in the eightfold path which Lord Buddha had shown to all of us, and following that, we can also develop love and affection towards our charity. And today, this session is devoted to the Buddhist art in Southeast Asia and others. So first of all, I would like to welcome Professor Prasanthi Nargoda from Sri Lanka. You must have.
Good morning to you all, respected Venerable, Honorable Chair and Co-Chair, and the distinguished guests and the delegates from ICCR India and Cambodia. Today, my presentation is about the emergence of Buddhist age in Cambodia and the impact of Sri Lanka. But I would like to pay my gratitude and tribute to Professor Sarabo with his consolidated statement yesterday with India's mission towards the collaboration and cooperation of Buddhism and Buddhist art. With the brotherly hand, and I'd like to say that Sri Lanka Sri Lanka extended the same hand towards its mission of spreading the message of Buddhism and Buddhist art throughout the Indian subcontinent. So with that, and under that canopy, I'd like to propose certain conclusions and assumptions based on my research. So Buddhism in Cambodia, we find it in developed in two phases. First, with the kind missionary services provided by King Dharma Ashoka during the 3rd century BCE from the Big Brother, as Professor Rao mentioned yesterday, rightly, and during the reign of King Jayavarman VII in Cambodia during the 13th century CE from Sri Lanka, that is under the patronage of King Parakrama Bapu. So the intermediary phase shows evidence of a blend of Theravada and Mahayana schools of Buddhism and those of Hinduism as well that imparted from Kerala region as well as from India as well, that we have to keep in mind when we talk about Buddhist art in Cambodia in particular. Forces for the transition about the Buddhism in Cambodia is threefold. That is, one, with the influence of Thailand. Number two is Buddhist missionary services provided by Sri Lanka with their missionary services. And number three, Cambodian monks to study Sri Lanka with the mission provided by Sri Lanka again. So the son of King Jayavarman, as an example, a very good example, from Tamilinda became a monk in Sri Lanka and studied Buddhism under the Sri Lankan monastic priest for some years. And he brought that Theravada Buddhist tradition back to Cambodia in terms of spreading and establishing the Buddhist philosophy in this soil. And Buddhism, with regard to the spread of Buddhism and Buddhist art in Cambodia, there are several phases through which we see that Indian extended hand as well as Khmer Thai transition and the tradition established through Thai Lopburi and Thai Ayodhya as well. So because we cannot find any territorial boundaries before the 18th, 19th century with regard to the geographical and geological demarcation in the Southeast Asian region. And my hypothesis therefore under such canopy, Cambodian Buddha image portrays the impact of Indian Buddha image. It's threefold and demonstrates the iconographic elements of Hindu deities as well and highlights the characteristics of Sri Lankan Buddha image. And with regard to the third hypothesis, I have some highlighted points why we propose such a assumption that Sri Lanka's contribution towards Cambodian Buddhism, the establishment of Buddhist faith. So there are certain reasons, factors, evidence that we find that you can see in this slide, that resident Sri Lankan monks became the main advisors to Cambodian kings during the 14th century. And as a result, Pali language became the state language one time. And Cambodian monks were dispatched to Sri Lanka to study Buddhism, especially Tripitaka Dharma, that is based on Pali language again. And monks who studied Tripitaka received ordination at the presence of Singhala Mahadevas under the headship of Post Venerable Manavaratseho. And King Parakrama Bahu VI was a very good patronage from Sri Jayavadhanapura to spread the message of Buddhism with his big brother India in and around South and Southeast Asia subcontinent to its vast majority today. And the importance of Angkor Kingdom in this regard is that King Jayavarman VII announced Buddhism as the state religion to help save the Khmer people. And the end result was Theravada Buddhism became the state religion of Angkor Wat after the century CE according to the literary evidence that we find. There are certain landmarks that when we talk about Buddhist art in Cambodia, some literary evidence. Lanka once spread north and west from Angkor into what is now Thailand and Laos, carrying with it also Angkor prestige, not just not the simple Buddhism. sacred script and the cult of divine kingship. And Ratana Bimba once, the history of Emerald Buddha, that we very popular and well-known image of the Emerald Buddha that we symbolize the sustainability, fertility, and the peace and harmony of this Asian region, describes that the Emerald Buddha image, the Thai national palladium today, came from Lanka, was to Ecuador, and only later traveled to Thailand as well. But there are certain other messages as well. It goes the other way around, as well. Some people say that it first came to Thailand, and then to Cambodia, and then to Laos and Vietnam as well. However, so it has been roaming around the South and Southeast Asian region, providing the symbolic sustenance of the region. That connotation has a contribution from Sri Lanka as well. The stupa in the central tower of Pasad Priya Vihar, my apologies at first, if I am wrong, you can always correct, because we are giving this information with a remote understanding. And this is Angkor Wat. And Buddha image in Cambodia, under such influence and inspiration, provided some blended categorical and iconographical characteristics with the Brahmana, Hindu, Mahayana, as well as Theravada Buddhist iconographic and iconometric characteristics. And King Jayavarman VII, whose patronage was there, to provide the image of the Buddha as a living symbol in the Cambodian territory. So there are three examples that I have provided here. He dedicated one image in favor of his mother as the Prachaparamita, one for his father as the Lokeshwara, and Vayon image dedicated to himself. And there are certain other literary evidence with regard to the image of the Buddha in Cambodia as a symbolic indication of the Cambodian Buddhism. And there are some indications. King Puyayat established five principal Buddhist Viharas monasteries headed by Sri Lankan Buddhist monks. The reason was the king was inspired by the Wathaya clone, which possesses the golden image of the Buddha that I spoke previously about, the Emerald Buddha originally received from Sri Lanka. So this is Wat Lanka. And Angkor Wat is the Buddhist regime period, even today, that has certain symbolic values and characteristics that imparts and disseminates the ideas and ideological thoughts of Sri Lankan Buddhist tradition, that is the Theravada tradition. And icons of the Buddha significantly reflect the characteristics of Sri Lankan Buddha image, as I have shown here. So this one is the Naga Buddha image found from Cambodia, which has a similar indication to the 4th to 5th century Theravada Naga Buddha image found from Sri Lanka. This is from Nagarjunakonda, Andhra Pradesh. So this clearly indicates the similar connotation to the Sri Lankan Buddha image. But that doesn't mean that solely depended on Sri Lanka. This Samadhi Buddha statue still again has the similarity to the Samadhi image belonged to Sri Lankan Buddhist, Theravada Buddhist tradition. This belonging to 1st century BCE, and the other one, the Samadhi, well-known Samadhi statue to your right, is the Mahamevuna Vera or the Mahamihara tradition. And there are certain other Buddha images we find from Bhuspasha Mudra, from Cambodia, which has a similar connotation to India itself. And this is Dharma Chakra, with the Buddha image with the Dharma Chakra Mudra, again that has a similar connotation to India. This is with the gesture of fearlessness. And not only that, Cambodian tradition provided significant typical iconographic characteristics in this image with the arms board providing the national and cultural heritage inherited by Cambodian people with the inspiration of Theravada Buddhist tradition. Even today, we believe that the Cambodian people are very generous and they are into that generous thought and mind. Therefore, my conclusion is that the Cambodian Buddha image portrays the impact of Indian Buddha image and as well as Hindu deities, highlighting the characteristics of Sri Lankan Buddha image, however providing its own iconographic elements that represent the Cambodian cultural identity at its best. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nargota, for giving some insight into the development of iconography in Cambodia and relationship with Sri Lanka. We all know that in the first century AD, almost, Buddha in human form had been depicted in sculptures from Gandhar and Mathura region, and then it develops into Gupta period around 4th-5th century, particularly in Sarnath, which influenced the style in so many countries. And then we also know that in 12th century Buddhism started diminishing in India, and very good evidence you have given that in the 13th century how Sri Lankan impact was there on Cambodia. Thank you so much. And now I would request Dr. Anura Mantunga, my friend from Sri Lanka, to please make his presentation on Bulan as well.
Is also considered as a it was first understood as a local dynamism, but now we know that we wanted to keep contact closely to Southeast Asia, because Pranav is more closer to Southeast Asia than Anuradha. He was from this coast. Eastern coast was very active during that period, and Pranav can be reached by the river Mahavali from the Trincomalee port. And so therefore, there was a very busy traffic during those periods in Southeast Asia. So Cholas also kept that in the Pranav as their capital city, and then after Sri Lanka, they also kept Pranav as their capital city. I'll skip all these things and then I will go through. And the city was ruled by 17 kings and it was lasted about 250 years. And most of the well-known kings of Pranav were Vijay Bahu the Great, Parakram Bahu the Great, and then Nisakamal. And Nisakamal is a person who came from Kalingar, Orissa, Sri Lanka, and ruled for 20 years there. And all are Buddhist kings. And it was again ransacked by Kalingar Mahadur and the Kalingar prince. He took support from some Kerala army and destroyed Sri Lanka for another 15 years. That's the short history of Pranav. And let's see what's the significance of Pranav. So that's, I already told, that's the second capital city of Sri Lanka. And it's the most prosperous period of hydraulic civilization of Sri Lanka. So Kambodja, this area is also hydraulic civilization. So therefore, Pranav civilization is also same as hydraulic civilization. And it's very important that yesterday I listened to some of your papers and understood that Cambodia has named some of the lakes as Samudra. And for the first time in Sri Lanka, during Pranav period, we built three tanks, name of Samudra. Parakrama Samudra, Parakrama and Sankamala Samudra, and like that, there were three Samudras, and they were not actually seas, but inland tanks or reservoirs. And that was the great last phase of the great civilization of Rajaratna. The most important thing is the diffusion of great and science towards Southeast Asia during that period. And let's see the monumental significance of Pranav. And Pranav, the most important, there are both Hindu and Buddhist monuments. But Anuradhapura, we can see only, I think Professor Lalitukta knows it very well, the incident there. And there are only Buddhist monuments. Viharas at Anuradhapura, but Pranav, we can see both Buddhist and Hindu monuments. And that also in Buddhist monuments, we can see some Hindu elements. Hindu monuments, we can see Buddhist elements at Pranav. And there were large stupas at Pranav. We know that there were large stupas at Anuradhapura, but they were ceased to be constructed in the 3rd century AD. But after 3rd century AD, again started construction of huge Buddhist stupas at Pranav in the 12th century AD. And most of the Buddhist stupas and other buildings have superstructures still preserved. And some of the most preserved big buildings are at Pranav. Another important reason, importance of Pranav is that there are secular buildings as well as religious buildings. At Anuradhapura, you can see only religious buildings, only viharas, monuments. But at Pranav, you can see palaces, council chambers, some other secular buildings. So, and so it is there. Therefore, Pranav is different from Anuradhapura, and it is very important of understanding the influence between Southeast Asia and Sri Lanka. This is the general view of Pranav. You can see the monuments, aerial view. And I am lucky to work there as a consultant director of UNESCO for 30 years. It's a very intense site. And this is super. It's well known. We call it a Giri Venera. And replicas of this super has been taken by Southeast Asian monks when they returned to Cambodia and Siam or Thailand or Myanmar after returning from Sri Lanka monasteries those days. So there are a lot of references on Buddhist monks who learned Sri Lanka monasteries during this period. And they were taken, replicas of these monuments, this area. And in Southeast Asia, we have a few type of bubble-shaped stupas. They were known as Singhala type stupas. Architecturally, we call them Singhala in Sri Lanka, Sri Lanka type stupas. And the other building includes. It's a huge image house called a Tanka Tilaka. And this is the cross up of the Kiriwitan stupa. And this is another huge stupa we call Rangkot there, Golden Pinnacle stupa, just enjoying the sacrament. And this is one of the Buddhist image house, but it has some Hindu elements, I mean, like it's the same as a Hindu building. And this is a peculiar Hindu temple. By Cholas. This is the most important secular site of Coronavirus. It is sacred for Tranka. This is one of the masterpieces of Sri Lanka art. And this is also one of the close up view of Tranka Village House. And this is the best preserved building in Sri Lanka among the rest of the buildings. It is a Tupara. So again, an image house. It's a Buddhist image house. Outside, it's like in the building. Another one. And it's the palace, Coronado Palace. And I go quickly. And then, now I come to my bed. Between these scientific issues. There are references in the Mahavamsa. Parakram attempted to settle this. Kambodji, most probably as the queen for King Kunwarman's servant. But that princess was kidnapped when she was taken to Myanmar. Because at that time we have come to Myanmar, Burma, and they have to use the land to Cambodia. So the king did allow to bring that queen for his mother. And then there was a war in Sri Lanka and Myanmar at that time, and that's the only reference in Sri Lankan history that we have invaded Samya, even South Africa. So we have invaded Burma and captured for some time, then came back. Due to this reason, and also some other trade disputes were there. And Cambodia is also referred to as one of the friendly countries. During the King Isakamala's time, there were two inscriptional evidence for that. Mentioned that Cambodia, among other countries, one of the most friendly countries. And another peculiar reference is found in one of the inscriptions. That inscriptions are found at Wangalisai and Anuradhapura. During Isakamala's time, it says that King prevented Cambodian people of killing birds. The chief that Cambodian were used to kill birds there. As a habit or as a ritual or something like that, but we don't know why. It says the king gave some gold and some garments and some kind of gifts to Cambodians and asked them not to kill birds. Yeah. So this is in an inscription. And again, we have a reference in an inscription called a Cambodia Vasa. Unfortunately, I couldn't find the original of this inscription, but it was mentioned in the late 19th century. Pioneer figures that one of the inscriptions it was referred to Cambodia Vasala. Vasala in Singhala means either palace or gate. It means in the 12th century we had the either palace or gate name of Cambodia. Since there were a lot of Cambodians and also there were a lot of influence on that. Then you see the real Cambodian elements. We have two monuments. One is Taj Mahal Plaza and the other one is Golconda. These two buildings so here Cambodian elements. So we can't see parallels in Sri Lanka. Must be. And this one of them, Taj Mahal Plaza. This is very peculiar. Sri Lanka, we don't have another example like that. But in this area, there are hundreds of this kind of buildings. The most similar building is this one. What to put in out of the Thai land area. But very similar to that one. And there are some other theories also similar to that. So only in the another empire you can find and this one for good, and this is also at Coronado, and this type of building they can't see anywhere in China, but you can see it. Only in Cambodia. See the map of the eastern near Newport Newport and Peru, exactly same. And this type of plan, they can't see any other place, either in India or in Sri Lanka. Only in Kothur here in Sri Lanka and also in Cambodia. So it clearly shows that the Cambodia is improved. And this image found at this image is highly controversial. I think that some people have identified Tigers as a saint or as a king. But I recently identified it as the image of Avalokiteshvara Amogha Pass. If it became Avalokiteshvara Amogha Pass, it seems that Cambodian influence is also there. Because during this period, Avalokiteshvara worship is prevalent highly in Cambodia and in Sri Lanka and other areas. Because I identified the thing that holding in the hand as a partial. Something like loop or something like that. So it is a symbol of Amogha partial of Avalokiteshvara. So I'm going to stop here because otherwise you will ring the bell again. So thank you very much for this.
Thanks very much, Dr. Mansunga, for giving so many evidences about Cambodian influence on architecture of Buddhist monasteries of colonial work. In fact, we are delighted to have the first two papers where in the first paper it is shown how Sri Lankan influence was there on Cambodian cultural art, and now you have given details about the architectural influence of Cambodia on Sri Lankan architecture of colonial work. So that shows the cultural undercurrent which was there in between these countries, Sri Lanka, India, as well as Cambodia in the remote past. So I once again thank you so much for this paper. And now I would request Sri Rajesh Sharma, who is from University of Jammu, to India to speak on what has been outstanding value.
Thank you, sir. This paper is good morning to all of you. This paper is co-authored by me and my guide, Professor Ramananda Singh sir. My topic is based on fieldwork. It is related to Buddhism in Jammu region. It comes under my PhD research work also. It is a fact that Buddhism is a living faith. It is a fact that Buddhism is a living faith and practicing religion in Jammu region also. In Kindwar district of Jammu region, Buddhism is still flourishing. The topic under discussion comes in Nakshari Valley of Kindwar. Here in the first slide, I have shown the map of India, wherein the map of Jammu and Kashmir is shown. And the Nakshari Valley is represented in red line. In the lower part of the slide, it shows all the valleys of Kindwar district, which is written in red. In the next slide, I have shown the area of research paper, that is Nakshari Valley, which includes village of Sia Raman and Namji, border area and Kindwar. Introduction of Buddhism in Jammu and Kashmir. The story of introduction of Buddhism to Kashmir is very fascinating and challenging. The Buddhist account as well as the Kashmiri chronicles like the Srimad Puran, Sabdhani Kalkulata of Shemendra and Rai Tangani of Kalhan narrates a death encounter of indigenous tribes called Nar with the Buddhist monk Mahandika. Mahavans explained that Mowgli Buddhist, the chairman of the third Buddhist council and the religious advisor of King Ashok was sent to Kashmir Dandar region for propagation, and he succeeded for showing various feats of his magical power. The Ashoka Padan also said that Emperor built 84,000 stupas and dharmarajka over the corporal relics of the Buddha in Kashmir. The fact is further supported by the Sri Lankan Chronicle Mahabharata, which states that Emperor Ashoka constructed 84,000 stupas in Kashmir. Nityananda states that Ashoka had wished to build 84,000 stupas. Here it seems that the number of 84 Tupa Chaityas and Vihara may be symbolic figure, may be symbolical figure. Next. After the third Buddhist council, the most important result of this council was the dispatch of missionaries to different countries of the world for the propagation of Buddhism. Ashokan Rock Addicts explained that missionaries were sent to far off countries in Asia, Africa and Europe. Nevertheless, it is beyond doubt that the Mauryan Emperor Ashoka got a number of Stupa Chaityas and Viharas built in Kashmir. The role of Kashmir in the propagation of Buddhism in India and abroad is also remarkable. Furthermore, a large number of ancient Buddhist sites are still extant in Kashmir. In Jammu region, a very well developed Buddhist establishment was excavated at Anbaran, which is about 32 km from Jammu city. It is primarily the site of Kushan period. This is my area of research, which comes in the district Kishtwar. The district Kishtwar lies between longitude 75 degree 25 minutes east and latitude 34 degree 10 minutes north. The area of Kishtwar is 7,737 square kilometer. It is bounded on the north by Ladakh, on the east by Padar and Chamba, on the south by Gondarwa and Chelani, and on the west by Kashmir. Kishtwar is situated on an open plateau on the left bank of Chenab, which is also known as Chandrabhaga River, which is joined by other tributaries. In Nirmal Puran, the reference of Chandrabhaga is also given, which runs as below. The historical reference to Kishtwar is also found in Kalhans Rajdhani, which mentions the original name of Kishtwar as Kastabanti. The history of Kishtwar, we find that the country was invaded and controlled by the king of Zuru in Ladakh called Hiri Sultan. The name of the Kishtwar was then changed to Bhotnagar. There is another explanation that the rulers of Zuru and Khatse near Kargil in Ladakh were called Hiri Gyalpo. Work on embracing Islam, they took the title of Hiri Sultan, pronounced as Three Sultan. And this would point to one of the Buddhist kings of Zuru or Tripte having been the leader referred by A.S. Penki. The word Khiri means throne is pronounced Thiri. And the Three Sultan mentioned in the Kishtwar history correspond exactly to the Three Sultan of Ladakh history. These chiefs resided at Zuru and Khatse and called themselves as Khiri Gyalpo, means throne king, before they became Muslims in the 15th century. We may perhaps trace a connection between this invasion and the Chinese invasion of Kashmir in 713 CE, as a result of which for many years afterward Kashmir continued to pay tribute to China. We may therefore assume that the conquest of Kishtwar by Khiri Sultan happened in the 8th or 9th century CE. A similar invasion of Brahmapura, the original name of the adjoining Champa state by the Kirat, most probably Tibetan, took place about the beginning of 9th century CE. And Kullu also was conquered by the Tibetans in the 12th century and remained for a long time subject to Ladakh. It is important to note that C.E. Waits also mentioned in his book that ancient route Sialkot to Kishtwar and from Sialkot to Kishtwar via Ramnagar to Bhadrava. These were the shortest route to the ancient Sakal and Sialkot, the first gateway of the plains of India from northwestern invaders. According to Dr. T.K. Pol, there was a trade route which passed through Nurpur, Chamba, Kathuwar, Patar, Jhanskar and Ladakh. In Patar Tehsil, of Kathuwar district, we have living Buddhist population and Buddhist Gompa and Suncha. These are the village mentioned I have already. Next, please. At Tilkuchi, we find some stone block of the figures and designs such as Subhat and Vajra in Basli. These styles of carving and relief work are a common feature of all over Kathuwar. In the next slide, I have shown the photographs of water bodies in local language called as Goldi. Here a stupa, you can see a stupa is in Basli. Here is a sign of Vajra in Basli. Next is the area which Nakshari Valley. Nakshari is the seal of Kathuwar district. I am not going to explain this slide. This is the Buddhist ruins at Siyadrama. Siyadrama is a name of village. Here I have found great historical importance has been ignored by the story and archaeologists. The ruins of this place reveal the tales of ancient culture and architecture highly praised by the people of this district. The particular place is indeed a treasure of archaeological value. There are four inscriptions found on broken images on a ballroom temple. These are in shorter script of four inscriptions. One taxi other one may be across the script. Next slide, please. This is the side view of the Thiyathaman. You can see here the ruins temple. Next. This is the temple front and back foot of temple, which shows that it may be made from the ruined temple. Next. This is the ruined structure in village Siyadrama. And near this temple, I have found ruined structure of approximately 12 to 15 feet. Opposite to this temple, I have also found small cells, 5 or 6 in number, with dimension approximately 3 into 4 feet. This is another entrance of another temple. These are inscriptions carved in the stone block which have not been deciphered so far. Another, this is another. And portrait left from the site of Deer Raman. And this is the main, you can see these two photos which I have found. One is a stone block on the ceiling of temple which I have found in Deer Raman. It shows lotus with 8 petals which has 4 levels with the upper level bearing scale. And same in another photo I have also found when I compared this. This is the photo from Spiti Valley, Kashigan Monastery. The ceiling has 4 levels with upper level bearing scale while the lowest grade as usual and octagon figure. During my finger to these sites I have also found 2 stone blocks. At Siyadhaban and other on the way to Dhanji site, which is carved with 12 petals of lotus. Thank you. This I have compared with the grass tree structure. Thank you. This is another village, Dhanji. Thank you. The photograph being shown, it has 4 spoke petals inscribed with a hole in the center and a statue also bold. This is another view of the site. And there is a small image carved with there. Thank you. On the stone is also found at this site. And in conclusion, the Nakshari Valley became a center of all the important regions like Nag, Buddhism, Shaivism, Vaishnavism, and Shakti. Carving and engraving of the doors, windows, and ceilings of the temples constructed all in wood, stone, etc. Is a best example of indigenous style of sculpted art of Kathuwar stone block with images of God crossed on them have been honored in Narsini Tehsil. The ruins of the temple and Deer Raman and Dhanji in Narsini offer us the insight into the old art and architecture of Kathuwar. A broken statue port in the temple and a roller design pinned along the pedestal of this image explicitly manifests the artistic work in it and also specifies the evidence of the indigenous style of High School of Art. Chakra with carving of 24 stones evenly distributed over the chakra and an idol probably of the Bodhisattva Maitreya Buddha form as Dhanji are propitious testimony to the art of sculpture prevalent in the Keto art. Thank you. Thank you.
For enlightening all of us about the task work which we are carrying out in Narsingi Valley, in fact, both Doda and Kishtwar region in between the Jammu and Kashmir, is an area which has not been very thoroughly explored, and we are all happy that we are doing this work for your research work. And we give all our best wishes to you. I would like to invite Dr. Bhuvan Kumar Jha to speak on Buddhists and Hindus in late colonial India.
Thank you, Chair. My topic is Buddhists and Hindus in late colonial India, appropriating religio-political categories. Not art, something else denotes more of culture and politics during the late colonial period, roughly from the late 19th century till 1930s. And it also talks about how certain political organizations, most prominently the Hindu Mahasabha, was trying to appropriate Buddhists and Hindus. And there were many discourses becoming prominent at this time, showing the inclusive character of Hinduism, where Buddhists, among other sects, were shown as indispensable, individual, part and parcel of the Hindu religion. There are four basic things on which I will talk today. One is the evolution of politico-religious categories during the late 19th and early 20th centuries. The second, the process of defining Hindus and incorporating Buddhists in the broader ambit of Hindu Sangathan. Third, Hindu Mahasabha's endeavor to count and aggregate Buddhists and Hindus and incorporating Buddhists in the organization and its conferences. And the last, Bodh Gaya temple debate about its management and Hindu Mahasabha's intervention. As we all know that the 19th century, there was a certain process of mapping of India's by the colonial government, and there were two most prominent instruments by which the population was being mapped. One were the compilation of gazetteers, and the second and the more important was the starting of All India Censuses. All India Censuses started from 1881, and every census, at every subsequent census, more elaborate categories were brought in, where everybody who was being counted had to also mark his religion. So there was a big departure during the modern time. On the one hand, the census operations treated Buddhists, Jains and Sikhs as groups separate from Hindus. On the other, the leaders of the Arya Samaj, and especially the Hindu Mahasabha, made attempts to show them as individual parts and parcel of Hinduism. The All India Hindu Sabha was founded in 1915, and in its very first conference, where the rules of the All India Hindu Mahasabha were inaugurated, were specified, it says, or it defined Hindu as any person, this was in 1915 at Haridwar, Hindu as any person professing to be Hindu or following any religion of Indian origin, and includes Sanatanists, Arya Samajists, Jains, Sikhs, Buddhists, Brahmos. It also said that the Sabha, Hindu Sabha, shall not cite or identify itself or interfere with or oppose any particular sect or sects of the Hindu community. So Hindu community was shown to be a conglomeration of various sects, including Buddhists, Jains and others. In 1923, a more elaborate discourse comes into existence, and that was when Vinayak Damodar Savarkar wrote his Hindutva. And this subsequently was borrowed by many Hindu nationalist ideologues. The name of the book was Hindu or Who is a Hindu? It was published in 1923 when he had just come out of the Andaman jails and was in Ratnagiri under house arrest. The very first entry of the book reveals, and it's quite revealing, a Hindu means a person who regards this land of Bharat Varsh from the Indus to the seas at his fatherland as well as this holy land that is the cradle land of his religion. Briefly summed up, he said, he is a Hindu to whom Hindustan is not only a Pitribhu but also a Punibhu. It meant that followers of all faiths like Buddhism who regarded India as their holy land were to be treated as Hindus. In Savarkar's scheme of things, the essence of Hindutva was located in the commonality of intelligence and experience. Therefore, in reality, a Hindu is one who has inherited and claims as his own the Hindu Sanskriti, the Hindu civilization, as represented in a common history, common heroes, a common literature, common arts, a common law, and a common jurisprudence, common fairs and festivals, rites and rituals, ceremonies and sacraments. An absolute overlapping of these features was not mandatory, but a Hindu has more of it in common with his Hindu brothers than, say, an Arab or an Englishman. Thus, Hinduism is the ism of the Hindus and must necessarily mean the religion or the religions that are peculiar and native to this land and its people. As a corollary, it was clarified that the term Hinduism must not denote the religion of the majority, but it must denote the religion of all Hindus. In other words, while the religion of the majority could be defined, denoted by the term Sanatan, the Shruti, Smriti, Purana, or the Vedic Granth, the rest of the Hindus could be denoted by Sikh, Arya, Jain, or Buddha Granth. Therefore, Hinduism or Hindu Dharm became the generic term to denote all these dharms as a whole. A similar position was taken by B.S. Munshi, a prominent leader of Hindu Mahasabha in 1935, when he was categorizing Hindus, and he said that Hindus as a community should celebrate all kinds of festivals including Buddh and Jain festivals, and said that Hindus will support and cooperate in such processions and religious functions and thereby strengthen the bond of amity between different religions comprising the Hindu community. So Hindu community was sought to be a conglomerate of different religious groups, not a single group. In 1938, the expatriate revolutionary Ras Bihari Bose, who was at that time staying in Japan in Tokyo, wrote two letters to Vinayak Damodar Savarkar, who was at this time the president of the All India Hindu Sabha, and he says that the most necessary work before the Hindus was to promote Hindu solidarity and then extend this attempt along this line to Siam, China and Japan, as Buddhism is nothing but a kind of Hinduism. All who are born in India, in Hindustan, are Hindus, no matter whatever religion they may profess. Just as all who are born in Japan or permanently settled there are Japanese, irrespective of their religions, Hindus should welcome into their national fold, apart from the spiritual fold, all Indians of whatever religion as Hindus. And he wrote a second letter around a couple of months later, the Hindu movement should not be confined to India alone. As I wrote in my last letter, the Buddhists are also Hindus, and every attempt should be made to create a Hindu bloc extending from the Indian Ocean up to the Pacific Ocean. For this purpose, the Hindu Sabha should take immediate steps for establishing branches of Mahasabha in Japan, China, Siam and other countries of the Pacific, and sending the representatives for creating solidarity around the eastern regions. In one of the annual sessions in 1927, the Hindu Mahasabha asked its delegates, the followers, to celebrate the national heroes, and among those national heroes, the names of Lord Buddha, Rana Pratap, Guru Gobind Singh, Shivaji and Sradhanand were also noted. Management of Bodh Gaya temple brought Hindu Mahasabha directly into the whole kind of issue. In 1891, the Mahabodhi Society was founded by the Sri Lankan monk Angarika Dharampal, and he came into direct conflict with the Mahant, not the Mahant, but the son of the Mahant after 1895. The case went to the Calcutta High Court also, who said that the title of the land should remain with the Mahant, the Shaivite Mahant. Then he went to the Congress Party also, there was a lot of conflict within. Then he moved to the Hindu Mahasabha. Hindu Mahasabha took up the cause of the management of the Bodh Gaya temple on behalf of the Buddhists. In the right earnest, of course there were some differences within, but they arrived at some solution in their resolutions, where some sort of management was created with both Hindus and Buddhist representatives as its part.
And from 1925 onwards, we see a large number of monks, Buddhist monks, also attending the sessions, annual sessions of the Hindu Mahasabha from China, Japan. In 1913,
the Hindu Mahasabha session was held at Ajmer in Rajasthan, where representatives, more than 100 representatives came from China, Japan, Ceylon, and Burma, and they attended on all the 4 days. In 1935, and to the surprise of many of us, Hindu Mahasabha elected Bhikshu Uttama from Burma as its president, and he remained president for the whole year. So that was a unique thing happening there. And that session also took up the cause of the management of the Hindu temple, of the Buddhist temple in Bodh Gaya. So it's significant to note that a sizable chunk of the Mahasabha leadership was in favor of leaving the management issue to the Buddhists, and several initiatives were taken in this direction. I will just conclude that while considering threats from other religious faiths, it was happening all in 20th century. Hindu Mahasabha and other political organizations were perceiving threats from religious organizations. It's pertinent to note that while considering threats from other religious faiths, the Mahasabha never saw Buddhism as a threat, but rather viewed it as an individual part of Hinduism. Its effort to rope in Buddhist leaders, not only from India, but also from many other Asian, including the Southeast Asian countries, and its sincere effort in intervening in the management issue of the Bodh Gaya temple on behalf of the Buddhists shows attempts at appropriation of political religious categories. This attempt was made more urgent by the specific circumstances of the time. Thank you so much, dear, for giving me that time. Thank you so much.
Giving insight into the politico-religious conditions and situations between the relationship of Buddhism and Hinduism in the late in the colonial India. Now, after this, the last speaker of this session is by Dr. Vinay Kumar, who is from Banaras Hindu University, assistant professor there, and who happens to be my PhD student of the Dr. Vinay.
Good morning to all of you present here. Before I start my presentation, although it is a very delicate one, and I have to praise the evolution and the spread of the Buddhist art in 11 of the countries of the Southeast Asia. It is very lengthy, so that I have squeezed my presentation into only few slides. And before I start my presentation, I would like to greet on behalf of India to all of you, because today is one of the auspicious day for all of us, and all of us are sitting here on the auspicious day of Teachers Day. And that is why on behalf of India, I greet all the teaching fraternity present here. So we know that by the beginning of the first millennium BC, the Buddhism had firmly established in the areas of Thailand, Burma, Java, and Cambodia. Buddhism develops art and architecture as visual aids for the propagation of the religious ideas in Southeast Asia. Buddhist stylistic art have given a great impact on the religious and secular life of the people in those related areas for more than 2 millennia, and thus Buddhism had created a great current of art in Southeast Asia. Under this artistic trend, many valuable artworks, the historicity of the Buddhist art tradition in Southeast Asia developed. So, coming to the topic, the main area, how it developed, it was through the trade lessons, and we can see this is all the areas I have taken. It is the mainland, the 5 countries, as well as the inland that contains the 6 countries in that one. So this is the map showing that one. Next one. So this is the exchange network in India and the Southeast Asia. How the people through to different mediums they came here, just like the pilgrims, the priests, the adventurers, teachers, scholars, as the rulers and traders. And yesterday we had a great discussion on the Silk Route as well as this cotton route, and this was the route how it came into that area. We can see the map here where the exchange network, the route in India and the Southeast Asia, how it had developed. The next one. So the great network, we can see it in the slide. Next one. So we can see here the development of Buddhist art in Southeast Asia, and I have divided it into the three phases. How in different three phases it has been divided. First is the introductory phase art, which lasted from the 500 years, and it was from the 2nd to the 7th century AD. And second was from the 8th to the 10th century AC, and the third from the 10th to the 15th century C. So in the first introductory phase, it was important for the acceptance and the growth of the religion. The close derivatives of the Indian models onto the earliest indigenous Buddhist art before date, and the setting of the political boundaries in the first phase. And in the second phase, the rising of the powerful Salian Empire in the central Java, we know that. And the famous Borobudur temple was constructed during this phase only. And the emerging of the Hindu Khmer kingdom controlling the southern mainland of the Funan and the Zelna. And the Dwarapati kingdom of the Mon people in the Theravada tradition by the 7th century. The great kingdom of Pagan in the Burma is another example in this phase. And in the third one, the decline of the Cambodian power, the waning of the Japanese influence, the end of the Chan independence, and the weakening of the Adyat Dwarapati, and the prominent emerging of the Dwais comes under this third phase. So development of the Buddhist art in Southeast Asia, it's everyone I told you earlier. So only I would like to just tell about these the few points, only few points in the Myanmar Buddhist art. It shared a Mon heritage with the Thailand, and it was strongly influenced by Sri Lanka, which was earlier told here by one of the professors here. And the first appearance of the distinct Burmese style and the oldest Buddhist structure remains coincide with the Pagan period in this one at Myanmar. In the Thai Buddhist art, the history of the early Thai Buddhist art represents two distinctive periods in Thai art. First, the Mon, and the second, the distinctive Dwarapati type. Dwarapati type was the standing Buddha appearing in the Vitakka Mudra pose. Another distinctive and the most popular Dwarapati stone image was the wheel imitation from the Ato wheel top pillar by the 10th century CE. And in the Cambodian Buddhist art, when we come here, around the 1st century CE, in the 6th century CE, it was absorbed into the northern regions, the Khmer Empire, which embraced the teachings and the artistic expression of the Buddhism. Angkor City, at Suryavarman under Suryavarman II, created the greatest monument of the architectural masterpiece, Angkor Wat. And after this one, during the time of Jayavarman VII, the Khmer sculptures monopolized the building that is adorned and turned massive towers, walls and terrace into a network of the sculptures, programming and the relief carving. And coming to the Vietnamese and Malay Buddhist art and Indonesian Buddhist art, I have just did everything, the phase wise, how it developed in different areas. So coming to the conclusion, directly conclusion, throughout the studies of the various Southeast Asian countries, a wide variety of the Buddhist art have been incorporated as the inhabitants of the particular realm within the Buddhist cosmos. As reflected from various examples, the cultural interchanges in the aspects of the religion, art, architecture, or intangible cultural heritage, such as traditional practice and belief influences each other, rather than one side being a prototype for the other. Buddhist art and architecture in Southeast Asia of the different periods and culture has its own uniqueness and identity, from which the examples of architectural masterpieces could be distinguished as important representatives of the various architectural styles. And every site is relatable to the history of the Buddhist propagation in different periods of the time. Hence, it can be stated that the Buddhist art spread widely and influentially to the Southeast Asian countries. Thus, it can be concluded that the Indian immigration and its ideas were the major influence upon Southeast Asian culture, shaping cultural expression from art, mythology, religion, and literature. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Vinay, for completing your presentation within 7 minutes. Now, I would request my before we have 5 minutes of time for question answer, but before that I would request my co-chair, Professor Lalit Gupta, to please come.
First, let me thank the organizers in the co-chair, Dr. Mani, admire him a lot because he has worked in our different experiences. For the excavation of the monastic complex, he did that. That's his first time in I do not have specific comments on the papers, we already done that. But I will just take an opportunity to talk about the emergence of local spots, which is a very healthy sign. We are going away from the Western model and the hangover. But I think there has to be a judicious mix of the local and global and the local. The theories which have come in terms of methodology are on the patronage. But the similarity is in the plans are there, so that means some mind is working at the level of the technical. And it is that influence. Other thing is, I would especially like to mention Dr. Anil Manchak, conference by joining the term of the cotton. I think that is the area like that. I have nothing much to say. It has been a privilege to be
spoken.
Thank you.
It's already 11:30, so I think we can conclude this session here, and there may be questions and comments on all the papers, so I would request the participants to please discuss it with the brothers on the dais at the time of that. Thank you, sir.
So from Clay, I'm not going to answer it today, it's even part of the book. វិក្កមិនក៏ដូចជាប្រធានសម្រាប់សម្រួលកម្មវិធីនៅក្នុងឱកាសនេះហើយជាកម្មវិធីបន្តសូមរដ្ឋនេនិមន្តព្រះធម្មគុសាចារ្យបណ្ឌិតធីសវណ្ណរតនាដើម្បីបានបង្គោលនៅក្នុងឧស្សាហ៍រីដល់អ្នកសម្រាប់សម្រួលក៏ដូចជាវិក្កមិននៅក្នុងការផងដែរហើយនៅក្នុងឱកាសនេះគឺយើងមកដល់មួយ30នាទីជាពេលវេលាដែលសម្រាប់កម្មវិធីព្រឹកនេះដល់ម៉ោង ចន្ទហាននិងអាហារថ្ងៃត្រង់ដូច្នេះសូមឲ្យសិក្ខាកាមទាំងអស់និមន្តនឹងអញ្ជើញទៅកាន់ទីកន្លែងដើម្បីឆាននិងពិសានៅអាហារថ្ងៃត្រង់ហើយបន្ទាប់មកនៅថ្ងៃនេះដល់ដែរគឺម៉ោង 1 គឺនិមន្តនិងអញ្ជើញមកដល់សាលនេះដើម្បីយើងនឹងបន្តកម្មវិធីនៅល្ងាចនេះដល់ដែរនៅទីនេះទៀតខ្ញុំសូមអរគុណ
Express my highest gratitude to Chair Dr. B.O. Mani and Co-Chair Professor Lalit Gupta and Finance Speakers for enlightening presentation. Next, I would like to invite Honorable Professor Dr. T. Suvarnakana to offer souvenir gifts to Chair, Co-Chair and Finance Speakers. The conference this morning is now at an end. I would like to express my sincere thanks to the most vulnerable and honorable guests, ladies and gentlemen, for paying attention and participation. So we have 1 hour for lunch time. We'll come back to the conference hall at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And we also have the various topics for discussion in the afternoon also. So please enjoy your lunch time. Thank you.
Open your eyes, unfold a dream. Witness the joy, a magical scene. It's a new place, a kingdom of wonder. Right time for a smile, and we rise thunder. It's a new place, a rising star. A kingdom of wonder, from Bolivia. Blessing. chanting your fight. It's all a wonder, a kingdom of wonder, a magical spell. You fall in under, it's a new place, a rising star, a kingdom of wonder, Cambodia. Follow the way of battle, the queen's lead. Wander afar, there's so uncertainty. Into the winter, a kingdom of wonder, a free.